supply chain management, at the same time IT shopping management. I find when IT supply chain management, the participation level is quite high because the nature of the course is like that. When I teach optimization, so as the course is mathematical, so the level of participation is less. So it is not like that each and every course, the participation level, if teacher wants, he can make it high. And because it depends on the type of course.
Well, that used to be an argument raised about statistics. My statistics teacher would say, oh, my course, no, my students don't like, that's why they give me a poor rating. But we found that that's not true. So there have been cases of you teaching statistics 101 and getting very good feedback. Right? So maybe it's in part how you teach statistics. So somebody shared with me in the statistics department, you know, when I teach probability, I talk about how they might win Toto. Toto is our lottery in Singapore. Ah, they are very keen. Because they want to make it this fast. Right? So you find ways to make the subject interesting, even though in itself it could be very dry.
I agree this point, but sometimes if we give first type of example many times in the class, so, because the instructor gets 40 class, he has to hand out it there, so he has to cover the course.
Yes, yes. I'm not trying to suggest that there is a solution to all your problems. And certainly I'm not the person to provide a solution to it. I'm not a magician, I don't have quick fix answers. I recognize that these are real problems, and all I'm saying is there may be ways that you could work around the problems if you think about it and try and somehow make them, find ways that will make them more interesting to your students, which comes back to my earlier point about, you know, the teacher being a part of entertainer. You have to put your students in. You cannot assume that these are eager learners who would sit there absorbing all the wisdom that you're giving to them. Right? You have to do some of the work yourself to hook them in, make them enthusiastic, make them interested, and make the subject relevant to them. One of the issues is that, you know, this is not relevant because I'm not interested. My parents forced me, it's not relevant to me. But might there be some way that you could make it relevant to them? Because that's crucial. Few of us learn things that we think are not useful, not relevant. We have too many things to deal with in life. Life's too short to be trafficking in the irrelevant. So make your subject relevant. Use examples that will make it relevant. Yeah? I think so too. Okay, so the student's role, to get back on track, hopefully. The student's role, there are these various roles, and again, some of these roles, students aren't aware of, such as, for instance, that they could be teaching as well. Because a lot of peer learning happens, right? Not on a formal level, but students can teach each other. And maybe teach them in a more effective way, because they're approaching it from their perspective. They understand what it is that they don't understand, what it is that's so difficult for them. So they understand what their peers may be experiencing. So teaching, using students to teach each other, right, would be something that would be should become a student's role. And we come back to the point, are students aware of their roles? Do we do enough to familiarize our students with the idea that they have certain roles to play at the university? Or is it a case of students coming in and saying, well, I've paid my fees, now you learn me. Right? If you don't, if I go out and I haven't learned, it's your fault. And they make that assumption because they are unaware that they have to be participating in their own learning. They have to be accepting some responsibility for their own learning. And that involves them playing various roles, such as some of these that I've listed here. And this is by no means an exhaustive list, which is why I've left some blanks, and there can be many more blanks. But one question you could be asking yourself at the start of every class, or every course, do my students know what is expected of them? Am I simply assuming that they know that they're eager to learn, and if they're not eager to learn, then that's their fault. I'm not going to do anything about trying to conscientize them or make them aware that they too need to be doing something. What time are we breaking for lunch? 1 o'clock? Okay, so I stand between you and lunch. I must. Huh? So, So we ask questions like how and why do students learn? And there are all sorts of learning theories which provide conceptual framework for how information is received, information is reconstructed by the learner, and retained by the learner. And that's very important, the last point. Students may learn, but for how long? Right? If they've forgotten it by the minute they leave the university, then what is the purpose of their education? Right? So how it's received, how they make meaning of it, and how it's retained and retrieved for subsequent application. Don't bother to look at this list in any with any. It's just some of the names of learning theorists. And you will recognize some of the names, I'm sure. But it's just to make the point that there are various learning theories. Okay? And as teachers, we ought to be familiar with some of them, but we don't really need to be too bothered if you don't know all of them. And some theories that you probably are already familiar with, I've listed here, constructivism, behavioralism, observational learning, experiential learning, brain-based learning, learning styles, humanistic learning, control theory of motivation, transformational learning, change theory, and so on, and the list goes on. But these are the more commonly referred to ones. But, yes? We will change that. BITS-Pilani will change that, okay? But I suppose basically you can summarize it into sort of three broad categories. Right? Behaviorism, stimulus response theories, right? Teacher inputs, student has the learning done. So whatever stimulus you provide for your students has a response from your students. So Skinner's kind of conditioned reflex, for instance. Cognitivism, which involves mental processes that we assume that students actually process the information. They don't simply receive or react to stimulus, that they could also be initiating. And humanistic, which is students learn from their experience. You know, which really comes back to the point of your colleagues who come in from the industry with experience, they learn from their experience. Very often learning does not have to be formal, right? So very briefly, this summarizes behavioral learning theory. I won't go through it, but as I say, if you want the slides, you're more than welcome to have them. Cognitive learning theory, and if you look at Garnier's 9 events of instruction here, you'll probably recognize that that's what you all do, right? We gain attention, we inform them of the objectives, we stimulate the recall of prior learning, we present the stimulus, provide guidance, we make them perform, we provide feedback on their performance, we assess the performance, and we find ways to enhance their retention. I hope that they go out slightly better informed than when they came in. Isn't that what we all do? Yeah, even though we haven't formalized a theory for ourselves. A lot of it is innate in us, I think. We've thought about it, we've done it, we just haven't put a name to it, as I said in lectures. And humanist learning theories have to do with recognizing that individuals are central to their own learning. They learn from their experiences. Right? They do, and then they say, yeah, what did I learn from that doing? Okay. So what? What kind of theories, what kind of concepts can I develop from that kind of learning? Having that, next stage, now what? Where do I go? Where do I go from here, from all this learning that I have acquired? Right? So it's a learning cycle, and that's essentially what Cope is saying in his learning cycle as well. You start with a concrete experience, you reflect on it, you conceptualize, and it leads you to further experimentation and to more experience and so on in a kind of iterative cycle. Okay. But I do want to look at this slide a little more carefully. And that is, when we are teachers, we really need to be aiming for. I'm not saying it's always achieved, okay, but we should at least set the goals high. We should be aiming for a transformative experience, transformative learning, rather than just assimilative learning. Right? And the definition is given here by Mesro and McGonigal. Transformational learning effects real change in your learners. They come in as one thing and they go out changed by that process, hopefully for the better. Yeah, I know. Sometimes I worry that we might be doing damage to our students. And you were saying that before they come in, they are already conditioned not to learn. Then the school system has failed, right? It's done damage rather than help students learn. But hopefully that's not what's happening at the university. Transformational learning should make them critically aware of how and why our assumptions have come to be constrained by the way we perceive, understand, and feel about our world. Many learners do come bringing preconceptions. Yeah? They come in with a certain set mold. What age do your students come in as graduate, as undergraduate students? 18? Yeah. So 18 or 19, yes. They are, you know, fairly almost adults legally. So they have certain notions that they bring with them, certain preconceptions that they bring with them, right? And some of these are good, some of these probably need to be unlearned. And one of the things they need to be to unlearn is to recognize that we need to be constantly questioning what we receive. The information that we receive needs to be constantly questioned, not simply to say, okay, I've received this 10 commandments from my teachers in school. It's sacred, it's inviolate, it's perfect for all times, and I don't need to do any more about it. Instead, as an intelligent human being, I need to be constantly questioning the information that's received. Even received wisdom, ancient wisdom, are they always tenable? Do these wisdoms change with changing times? Okay? So the critical mindset, the questioning mindset, hopefully that's something that we can inculcate in our learners. Because only then will they be lifelong learners. If they're not constantly questioning, they're not going to be constantly learning new things. They will think that I have learned, not that I can go on learning. And then all we would have done is to provide assimilative learning, the type of learning that takes place when students simply acquire new information that can easily fit into their pre-existing knowledge structures. In other words, no real change. Right? They're just fleshing out what they think they already know. Yeah, they get a little bit more information, they know a bit more about civil engineering, maybe now they can even build bridges that won't collapse. Will they be thinking innovatively of new ways to build bridges that might be maybe more cost-effective or more robust or whatever it is that engineers talk about? I don't speak engineer speak, so I shouldn't go on telling you what engineer students should learn. But, you know, to have them continue thinking, that's really what we need our students, to make our students do. So that they don't feel when they leave the university, this is the point at which my education ends, and I can stop thinking. Rather, this is the beginning. I've got the basics. I will be equipped to go on thinking about these basics and to construct new knowledge, new wisdom based on these such information. What in your experience really enables learning? Here again, I'd like to pause for you to think of one aha moment that you've had. Don't tell me you haven't had any in your many years in formal education. As a student, right? Do you remember an event when you said, aha, now I understand? And what was it that triggered that moment?
So that was the occasion at which this has been, we have been seeing it from as a kid, the steam engine working, but then when I tried to understand as to what was the theory behind it, was the time at which I realized that this is what it is.
And what prompted you to, what triggered that?
I can't really understand this.
So you got excited
about steam engine because you saw it. I see. Okay. Right. So when you found out how it worked, that was your aha moment. And how did you find out how it worked? By reading about it yourself?
In the classroom.
In the classroom. And had it anything to do with the instructor?
Absolutely. He actually demonstrated. Those days, the simulation software were not there, so he just drew it and then demonstrated it on the blackboard.
Okay, so this is one instance where a good teacher made you see the light.
Yeah.
Right? Okay. Any other experiences that people want to share? Yes.
So I'm a biologist and I was interested in the origin of life. So in biology, when we look into, the proteins which are selected, actually they have the L form of amino acids, and the carbohydrates which are selected, they have D form of amino acids selected in the carbohydrates. So I was interested in knowing what is the difference between this and why carbohydrates are selected for the D form of amino acids. When I was in actually one of the discussions in BHU, one of my professors, when we discussed, it was a long question because in our time we're not having much of the key resources available that time. So in one of the discussions he pointed this point, and that was kind of a moment for me in my class.
So again, it's instructor specific. Yeah. Okay. Any other
thinking or reflection?
Through your own thinking and reflection. Yeah. Certainly, yes. Very often, when you're going through something yourself and you say, I got that one, yes. And you get really excited because you got it all by yourself. Maybe even more excited than when somebody pointed it out to you.
Yes. So when you solve a problem on your own,
yeah.
The solution, maybe it's a numerical solution, and then it matches with something that you observe, and then you suddenly understand why it's so important.
So the aha moment comes with the confirmation, the validation by another source?
Yeah, it's like if I do the problem on my own and get an answer which matches with what somebody has been telling me, understand it at that point, not because the other person
came. Not because, yes, because you solved it yourself. In a way, I suppose you did receive some sort of confirmation from another source. And that strengthened your aha moment?
No, it was only when I did it on my own that I actually understood what it meant.
Okay, so you already knew the answer that...
The answer's been told, but I don't understand it.
You don't understand it, yeah. Okay, so it's the understanding. It's the understanding, yeah? It's working through the process and understanding it. So yes. There are various ways in which learning can happen. It can be through instruction. Yes?
I just learned at home.
Yeah.
During my bachelor program,
yeah.
There was something called as dynamic RAM. And the explanation that has been given, I'm not able to capture it what actually it is. At home, we don't have refrigeration. And
refrigeration. Yes.
If we prepare any food with coconut,
after
some 3-4 hours, we have to reheat it. We have to reheat it to maintain the quality of the food. So what my mother used to do that, she used to reheat before 4-5 o'clock and after 8 o'clock, then we take the dinner. So the same concept is there, the dynamic RAM. One refreshment unit will be there. It keeps on posting the data into that. Take a copy of it and place it over here. So that I captured data, and really I'm very happy to know by myself.
Right. So you were able to sort of apply it to an actual practical experience. Yeah.
So I got to understand about what is the dynamic RAM, and even how some students they feel it very difficult to understand certain concepts. I try to correlate with their own field of interest. What is they know about it and try to bring in scenarios.
So this is how you should be applying it to your own experience, yeah? Mm. So there's a whole list of ways in which people can learn, right? And I'm sure you'll have experience with all of them. Instruction, observation, imitation. Children learn by imitation. And you wonder how they learn a language. They pick up ever so quickly. You don't actually teach them to speak it. They just listen to people talking and then they pick it up. And it seems to be a very effective way of learning. Now I went for French classes for 2 years. And I cannot claim to be at all proficient in French if I lost most of it because I didn't get practice. But a child, I have a niece and a nephew, they went to live in Bordeaux for 9 months. After 9 months, they were speaking like natives. Yeah. And the same thing happened when I went for sabbatical. My daughter came and joined me, and she was 4 then, and had no English because we speak Chinese at home. But within a few months, she was speaking like a native again, with no real formal instruction. So you can learn by observation, by imitation. So don't underestimate what your students might be learning, even though you may not be directly communicating to them. You are indirectly modeling. All teachers model through their behavior, learning practices, and so on. And you can learn by listening, trial and error, social interaction, self-study, experience-driven, active learning, making, and so on. And different ways of learning results in different retention rate. This is through studies done, not something that I've done, but it's interesting to note that when people are actively doing something, they learn better. As you say, when you solve the problem yourself, you understand better. And more important, you retain it for longer. And you are able to apply it to a different context. You don't just remember it for that one problem, you can solve another problem because you've understood the basic concepts. Now, as a literature person, this is something that's relevant to me. For learners, there are different registers of learning. For a student of literature, for instance, they're code users, they use the language, yes, but more important, we also wanted to move on to being code analyzers, and they can actually analyze the text and understand implied meanings, subtext, rather than the overt text. Then they become text users, and eventually they become meaning creators. So you have a continuum. An ascending continuum. And that should be the kind of model that any other discipline can be adopted, right? Not just as a code user. You don't want them just to be proficient in whatever basic engineering that you teach. You want them to be able to evolve into people who can analyze, who can think, and who can create new knowledge. Not just receiving the basic knowledge by creating new knowledge. Now, as a quick sum up, the literature has shown that there are 3 key findings about the science of learning. I know we talk a lot about theory of learning and so on, but if nothing else, take this home, okay? That in order for students to develop competence, they must have a deep foundation of factual knowledge. Now sometimes when we talk about creative thinking and critical thinking and so on, we forget that, you know, there must be a foundation on which to build this, to be critical about, to be creative about. Right? And we must be careful not to throw away the baby with the bathwater. It's all very well to be creatively thinking, but what are you creatively thinking about? You can be creative about building a bridge, but if you don't know the mechanics, right, that's never ever going to make you into a good engineer. You can imagine all sorts of fanciful structures. But will the bridge stand human traffic? If you don't You don't know the fundamentals. That's not going to happen. So you need, students need to have a deep foundation of factual knowledge. So we mustn't shortchange them on that as well. Now, they don't necessarily need to do that in class. The curriculum is not to be thrown out. The curriculum is important. But not all of it has to be done in class. A lot of it students can learn on their own.